Hi, my name is José Luis, and welcome to this video where I'm going to teach you how to use WebSocket communication to coordinate the motion of a two-dimensional canvas with a moving dot and use that to drive the position of a sphere on top of a nerves in Rhino and Grasshopper. It's going to look something like this. So here's my 2D canvas. I can click anywhere on the screen, and you can see that there is a back-end communication through a WebSocket server that I implemented in my previous videos, and that I can be used to animate and to coordinate the motion of where this sphere on the 2D parameter space of the surface is going to be. So I can use this to move things around, you know, and to move the sphere in real time. Even though you are using this, I'm doing it in my machine, I want to make sure that you understand that this is going through a cloud service, which means that I could be doing this from different machines in different parts of the world. So with no difference, okay? So you want to take a look at how that's implemented? Let's do it. Okay, so let's start working. As I said, I'm going to use the file that I used in the previous video as a template, and I'm going to build on top of that. And the first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to create a nerve surface that I'm going to model in Rhino, like a static one. I could do it parametrically, but it's not the point of this exercise. So I can imagine you modeling your own parametric surface and then using that as the input for the navigation of the sphere. So I'm going to just create a random nerve surface. So for example, I'm going to do this, and then I'm going to do another one that is going to be more like a little wavy. That's a little too much. So maybe what I want to do is something that is more like, that is a terrible curve. I don't like it. But anyway, so I'm just going to move this here to the side, and then I'm going to loft a surface between this and these two curves. And I'm going to get something like this, which if I do a shaded view, looks something like this. I don't like this. I'm a little picky when modeling surfaces. I'm just going to do this like that, something like that. All right. And then I'm going to loft. I'm being a little picky here. Yes. So I'm going to loft this like this. All right. Okay. And then I'm going to bring this into Grasshopper by using a surface component that I'm going to set to this object here. Pretty easy. Okay. Then what I would like to do is I would like to modify this C# script that I did here. And what I would like to do is I would like to use this script to take the surface as an input and then take these normalized coordinates that are coming from the WebSocket server, so values in X and Y from 0 and to 1, and then find the point along this nerve's surface that corresponds to those normalized coordinates. The output of my script, instead of a circle, is going to be a sphere. So let's work with that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a new input here. This is going to be the surface, for example, and I'm going to right click on the input and make sure that it's of the type surface. And then the output, I'm going to rename it and I'm going to call it sphere. And this is going to break because the code inside is referring to a circle object. So now I'm going to plug this in here. Everything else can pretty much remain the same. The point that we're using, the radius, and the radius is going to have to be much larger. But anyway, so I'm going to remain the easy, and I'm going to keep the easy in there, and then I'm going to write my code here. If you remember from the previous exercise, we defined two points that are going to be where the sphere is at any point, at any given time, and where it should go. And we define them all the way down here, because this is the area in the C# script component where the data is persistent across different solutions, across different updates of Grasshopper. And then all the way up here, I'm going to keep this loop, no problem, like this. I'm going to keep the target and the easing this way here. The only thing that I'm going to need to change really is, instead of outputting a circle, I'm going to need to output a sphere. So how does that work? Well, let's just get rid of this code here, and then I'm going to call sphere S, and it's going to be a new sphere that is going to be on top of some point. However, that point, I actually need to calculate that point, because what I have here as positions x and y are the normalized coordinates on top of the surface. So from 0 to 1 and from 0 to 1 on the other direction. I actually need to figure out, given how big the surface is and the curvature, what Euclidean point, what actually xyz coordinates that corresponds to in Rhino world space. So I'm going to have to do an operation before, which is going to be find Cartesian point for UB coordinates, all right? And because we're going to take position x and position y as the UV coordinates on this nerve surface. What I'm going to do then is I'm going to say, for this surface, can you please find the point at in coordinates u and v? So that's going to be position x and position y. Which point in those UV coordinates are you going to get? And this is going to be point 3D sphere center, for example. Right? This is not going to work, but I want you to see why it's not going to work. And then let's complete this code. So before we do that, this code is working. We have no errors. Okay, so then let's do the sphere. It's going to be a new sphere in what coordinates? It's going to be at the sphere center. So that's one thing. And the radius is going to be what is coming in from the input. And then I'm just going to output this component. I'm going to output this geometry, okay? All right, so I think we should be close to done, but we're not really. So let's say, for example, I'm going to plug in here this geometry object, and I'm going to see that right now this sphere is here, okay? Does that make sense? Well, let me see. I'm going to make sure that I'm connected. I was not connected to the socket, so I'm going to connect again, all right? So that's good. And I'm going to also make sure that the server is not asleep, because remember, glitch sleeps every 5 minutes or so. And now I have this. I'm going to reload this. I'm going to reconnect to the server. And I have this. So I have this. And you can see that I'm moving my ball, my dot here in the circle. All right. But it's not really working. The sphere in Rhino is not moving, but it's actually it is moving. If we look closely, it is moving. You can see how it's kind of moving. All right. So one problem is I have forgotten to add the trigger so that we have a live update cycle and the ball is literally moving between targets. So you see, so that's one problem. The next problem is I'm doing this, but it turns out that the sphere is not moving along the whole surface. It's only moving around this really tiny corner in this corner here. This is because remember that surfaces and curves in Rhino or in general can have a domain for each one of the directions u and v that can go from any value to any other value. And because I am finding here the point which is at UV coordinates with values from zeros and ones, maybe this surface has an U and a V space from 0 to, I don't know, 50. We actually can check that by deconstructing the domain here in, for example, U. So for example, let's check this out. So for example, U goes from 0 to 24 and V goes from 0 to 43. So this is 43 units in nerve space, and this is 24 units long in nerve space. And because we're moving from 0 to 1, we have a very reduced space here. It's only moving on the tiny corner at the beginning. So the only thing that we need to do is we need to change the internal domain of the nerve surface so that the full length of the surface is 0 to 1. And then that is a very simple operation that we can do before we use the surface here. So for example, what I can say is surface domain, set domain, we can set the domain in the direction 0. I don't know if it's u or v, but in the first direction, we can set it to a new interval from 0 to 1. from 0 to 1. Okay, and then for the other direction, I can also set the domain in the direction 1, so the second one, also to a new interval, from 0 to 1. This that you have here is what typically, this is what when you right click on a surface and you reparameterize it, this is exactly what you are doing with the surface. So if I do this now, hopefully now my sphere is actually going all, so if I move to like the very very corner, you can see that it's very close to the corner. Now I can move to the other corner and it goes all the way to the other end. Now I can move to the other corner right here, and then you see that it moves to the other end and to the other end of the corner, and more or less, I can also move it to the center. All right, so this is great. So things are working, more or less. And perhaps the last thing that I would like to do is that, depending on how you're looking at the surface, okay, you can understand UV space in different ways. But let's say that the most common way of looking at the space is going to be from this view, from like a top-down kind of view. And therefore, if we do that, then you can see that, for example, X is flipped, but Y is kind of matching this P5JS sketch. So basically, the problem is that I have created the surface with the U space being positive in this direction. So the only thing that I need to do is either flip the surface, which I don't think that worked. Did it work? No, I don't think that worked. So that's one thing. Or I can reconstruct the surface, making sure that the direction is going in this direction. So what I can do is I can delete this, all right? And then I can just loft the surface. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to make sure that I'm lofting it from here to here so that the U space goes in this direction. And then this is what I'm going to bring in now. And therefore, now I have, yep, I think the two directions are matching. So, yep. So now I have this sphere that is moving over the surface in coordination with my P5 sketch. All right. And let me remove this video. Yes. So, yoo-hoo! So we got it. So we have this sketch here, this one, and we can move the sphere. All right. Ta-da! I think this deserves a subscribe push, right? Subscribe, like. Okay. All right, so hopefully, and this was a good example that illustrates how we can use WebSocket communication to coordinate geometry, positions, coordinates, and a lot of different things between different platforms. So in this case, we have a 2D canvas environment, like a P5 sketch. And on my other hand, I have a two-dimensional space defined by a surface, which lives in three-dimensional space. So I'm using the internal two-dimensional space here to map the relation between the 0 and 1 normalized coordinates of the canvas to the position of the sphere. I could use this technique that I have explained for many things. I could exchange full meshes, I could exchange polylines, I could drag things around, and it's just a matter of, instead of just sending simple X and Y data, I could send arrays of coordinates, signifying X, Y locations of a bunch of points for the polyline. I could do a lot of things. I could send text, and I could use that to coordinate geometry, to generate geometry. I think the sky is the limit. So far as you are able to represent geometry in a way that can be encoded as text with properties and numbers associated to that, anything else is just a matter of imagination, okay? So thank you very much. I hope you liked this video. If you did, consider hitting those fancy buttons here in the description. And we're going to keep, this video is part of a playlist called Fun with WebSockets. And in the next few videos, I'm going to be talking about other ways of making different processes, talk to each other. And I will be expanding very at the very end when I explain Telegram bots. I will be connecting a Telegram bot to this Grasshopper definition so that I can actually move that sphere from my phone. I am literally going to be typing on my phone the coordinates and they're going to move on the screen. It's going to be super cool. Stay tuned for that. Thank you for being here and see you on the next videos.